Welcome back to The Checkpoint. With me is Council Edgar Tabaro and Mr. Joseph Ochieno, who are discussing politics and justice, a case of Sewanyana and Segirinya, who returned to Parliament today. And just before we broke off, we were talking about the negotiations that could have taken place for these two to come out of jail. Council, you just made alarming allegations that have actually been denied.
Given opportunity, I can substantiate my allegations.
Because these accusations have been peddled by certain people in our society, but at the same time, there have been counter accusations about these
negotiations. I've been Dean of Law School. I've practiced law in Uganda for 23 years, law within and outside Uganda. I've been a visiting professor at a number of universities. It's not in my place and the person of my background to come and make such statements on public television without confidence in what I'm saying.
Very interesting. So where does that leave our supposedly independent arm of government?
Those ones being?
The judiciary, because the judiciary here was in charge of doing the bail administration.
You know, the sitting president is he came to power through violence. So when it comes to politically motivated violence, that is his territory. So and politicians the world over engage in horse trading, what in Uganda they would call mpankuwe, give and take. And the judiciary decides on what has been brought before it. Persons lodge an application for bail, the prosecutorial ambit of the justice, law and order sector does not oppose it. What must the judiciary do? Remember this against the background of having opened, come up with my opening statement was that when bail was granted and they were rearrested, that was wrong. We must respect the institution of the judiciary. But where the DPP does not object to an application or withdraws, even the DPP has the power, the authority to withdraw. Save that there's something we always overlook. The Directorate of Public Prosecutions is supposed to be an independent institution of the executive. Mm. It's an appendage of the executive, but semi-autonomous. And the terms and conditions of the DPP are similar to those of judges, but they are not sitting judges. They are not sitting judges.
But
a DPP can be easily removed, more easily than a sitting what? But they are independent in exercise of their functions.
Correct. Let me bring in Joseph here. What are your views on these negotiations and the role of the judiciary as he's putting it?
You know, Edgar gave a very clear opening remarks, and I'm glad actually that in opening it as objectively as he did, he then went on to make those very important remarks. The point is this, that the courts did what they rightly were supposed to do on the basis of the evidence and the information in front before them and within the provisions of the law. The state was massively in error to have done what they did, and it actually It rubbed onto them. Had this been a freely open democratic government, you'd have said that they really, really burnt their fingers to the extent actually now that there is this negotiations, regardless of the underlying facts as suggested or perhaps as nuanced, it tells you that actually even that they've been burnt because they've really been presented as bad-mannered guys. I have said on this program and many others, in fact, on your station and others, that all the state needed to do, particularly because these are legislators, as early as that time, if it was clearly the case that these guys, you know, had cases against them, they needed to provide them, number one. But number two, in the then likely event, as it would appear, that there were grounds for concern after they'd been bailed. Mr. Museveni is a military man. Mr. Museveni has lived a military life for the last nearly, you know, less than five years of my life. You know, it's been literally, you know, that. Mm. He must have the capacity to monitor these guys. So really, there is no way, if they so wanted, if these guys were flight risks after having been granted bail, that they would not have provided alternative means of securing these guys in Uganda and making sure that they don't fly out, you know, than to go and set precedent by having them rearrested. The problem is that now in future, a future UPC government would find it could find it very easy to rearrest Museveni because it so have happened.
Amazing how you're dreaming about a future UPC government.
Of course, and that will happen. That will happen in the future. But we need this.
Kindly allow me cut you short.
We have had very unlikely people become president. Can you even imagine
some very unlikely people become president and then they bust? But anyway, on this very particular issue,
let's
as you
not
say,
get there. Mm-hmm. But let me just cut you short. Mm-hmm. Do you see politics overshadowing the administration of justice?
It has always been, and that's been the case in the last 40 years, which is very unfortunate.
Was that the case when the Chief Justice then, who was put a task to decide whether the pigeonhole constitution was illegal or an illegality, and then he had no way out. Do you think that was politics?
No, that was a democracy.
What do you think about that?
if you are going back to the events of 1966, that was a revolution. Mm. In law, it's what they call a revolution. He overthrew a constitution, and a new constitution order took effect. And I wouldn't like to go so much into the politics of the time because it will drag on.
Yes.
But President, Prime Minister Obote at the time was responding to, in his words, fifth columnists. Mm-hmm. There was a coup attempt, a push really. If I call it a coup attempt, maybe it may not really amount much to a coup attempt. But there was a push led by Ibingira, Grace Ibingira, who was this guy from Busoga, Govi. Mm-hmm. Govi, there was Ibingira, Magezi, Kiria, Barachi. They were involved in a push which was orchestrated. There was a fallout in UPC, ideological fallout, the leftists and the right wing. The right wing, which was really Western backed CIA, they were plotting a coup and they were using one of the traditional institutions in the country, and they had imported the cache of arms to remove Obote. So he acted very fast. Overthrew the constitution, suspended the constitution. Suspended the constitution. We started with an interim constitution, the so-called pigeonhole, then later the 1967 Republican constitution. Now, in the practice of law, there's what they call the law of politics and the politics of the law. So the overriding norm is the constitution, which is supreme. And fortunately, depending on how you look at it, in 1995 we enacted an instrument that we gave to ourselves and bequeathed to posterity, the Republic of Uganda Constitution 1995, the objectives of state policy, the background to the constitution, is all blah, 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 recording our constitutional history that has been checkered and, you know, characterized by instability, so we are now attempting to establish a lasting constitutional order. Now, as to whether or not we are deepening that is the question of the day. Now, you're putting the judiciary under the spotlight, and I wish there was a representative of the judiciary, but I'm an officer of court. By the way, throughout Uganda's post-independence administration, the judiciary has always tried to assert its independence. When they suspended the constitution in 1971 and it was ruled by decree, the judiciary was cowed. But nevertheless, once in a while, they would come out fighting. There was a time Idi Amin passed a policy regulation, that a policy on miniskirts, and there was, he later became DPP justice, rather he later became judge, Wilson Chitio, Musisi Chitio, he was chief magistrate of Buganda Road. They brought a person for prosecution, to prosecute a person before him, arrest the person before his court, based on a policy statement, a statement, roadside statement that Dimini had said. Then he referred to it as idle talk. This is the chief magistrate referring to the president's whatever as idle talk.
Idle talk, yeah.
So I'm giving that as a background, that the judiciary has tried to assert itself in as far as independence, its independence is concerned. And over the years, we see challenges. Even in Obote II, surprisingly, some of the judges who came out very boldly, especially when it came to aspects of human rights.
Yes.
There was a notorious practice
even
of arresting people.
There
was a notorious practice of detaining people without the detention orders that were signed by your late colleague, Dr. John Louis Akirunda. But we had the judges fiercely coming out to assert themselves. And some of the judges were what were thought to be very UPC leaning. And I'll give you a good example. Late Justice Arthur Hagai Odell was one of the persons, I mean, he was from Lango, like Dr. Bote, and, well, he was UPC leaning, but he really came out to assert the independence of the judiciary. Then post-1986, we had assurances of deepening judicial independence. However, over the years, we see some, you know, fault lines arising.
Some declines.
No, not really declines. Declines. There's always a clawback. There's always a clawback. Some individual judges buckle up and pander towards executive pressure,
but
and become more executive minded than
so
whatever. But
when we get back
over
to
the last over the last 40 years.
What does this mean? That background that you have given for the judiciary, what does this mean for the justice system?
One, we have a robust procedure, robust process. We have robust institutional mechanisms to protect the independence of the judiciary. However, the independence of the judiciary is a 360 degrees. It's 360 degrees approach. You don't just have an individual judge asserting independence. There's also institutional what? Independence. Then there are also appendages to the independence of the judiciary, like those of us who practice law before it.
Yes.
Eh? Mm. Believe me, there are many decisions I disagree with, but you must respect a decision of court, regardless of who you are. I can't go out in public and lambast a judge or the entire institution for even erroneously deciding. I'll say, I disagree with respect, and if I must appeal, I will appeal if I have those instructions. So, the independence of the judiciary should not be looked at in isolation with the general trend, the mindset and the outlook of the Ugandan people, and particularly we, the so-called elite, the intelligentsia. And I must add, we, the intelligentsia, I've said it before on this show and elsewhere, we are the biggest problem of the Republic of Uganda.
Just
we don't demand accountability. Even the non-political elite, we don't demand accountability. We don't hold our leaders to account, even where there are glaring examples of bad governance. We do not bail the cat.
Thanks for that submission, but I want to bring in Joseph. Up from the arrest of the two honorable MPs, Sewanyana and Seginya, through jail time to bail and now to entering parliament this afternoon, what impression is given to fellow legislators who may want to tell the same line like these MPs, what could happen to them in the future?
That was possibly part of the mission and possibly the message, regardless of the details, including the revelations by Edgar today. In fact, I am wondering Could it be in part that some of these legislators had some of this information that the public did not have, that we don't, to the extent that these guys feel, and once upon a time they complained that they had been abandoned by their party leader, they complained that they'd been abandoned by their party, in many cases then they complained that they'd been abandoned by the assembly, a parliament. I have struggled to see evidence that the assembly was necessarily concerned that their own were incarcerated and pleading innocent. And these are parliamentarians, historic in this country, that parliamentarians are held and tortured and beg and released on bail and rearrested, and the innuendos and rumors.
Is there evidence of their torture? I don't think there's evidence of their torture.
Well, these were all claims and allegations, just as we're putting everything else, you know, and that the rest of their colleagues don't come to the rescue of the situation in terms of asking this. And so for that, including then today, as I said, there is nothing celebratory about the whole thing in the assembly. So it tells me that perhaps maybe it may end up working in favor of the state that might consider that future legislators or future political elite don't consider being rather robust with their politics. But for me, being UPC, and for me being Joseph Ocheno, who doesn't believe in violence and I reject the idea that anybody should be
UPC
pinched.
UPC doesn't believe in violence?
Of course we don't, you know. But no, we were compelled.
You were compelled.
The disclaimer that... let me make you happy. The disclaimer
you
that...
You were the lead against Idi Amin.
Precisely.
And of course, struggle.
And that was...
Can I protect
you? Indeed. And the disclaimer was...
Kikosi Malumu of the UNLA.
Indeed.
Kikosi Malumu was basically UPC.
No, of course, well, of course we don't. And
it was a UPC outfit.
Absolutely.
So do you say to that extent, do you wish to qualify yourself because you don't believe in violence?
No, that's the disclaimer saying, to the extent that UPC, knowing that Ugandans were being slaughtered, to use Obote's language, knowing that the Chief Justice had been killed, knowing that the Archbishop had been killed, knowing everything else that Amin had done, and knowing that a democratically elected government had been overthrown, no. We had to, you know, mobilize, you know, quite reluctantly to mobilize and ensure that, no, we were able to reclaim Uganda, and indeed we reclaimed Uganda in 1979 April. And it's really a shame, actually, this week, isn't it, that after doing that, we've had another 40 years of dictatorship. So, no, we generally don't believe in this. So, really, the alternative is, on a serious note, that once we have a democratic dispensation, somebody is elected, political leaders across the political divide should make sure that we respect all the institutions, as Edgar suggested. But in this case, that if people are parliamentarians, what I like to see in this National Assembly are men and women maturing and growing to learn how to engage on genuine political discourses so that it becomes a competition of ideas, competition for public opinion, competition for genuine votes, you know, so that the institutions we are discussing includes the Electoral Commission, so that when matters go to the Electoral Commission, it's a due process. And when matters go to court, political process go to court, it's open and genuine, and that judges, you know that Obana Jesus is looking up heaven, sometimes Comrade Mohammed, so that things are done generally fairly. So yes, legislators should be geared towards going through the rule of law, the political process, democratic process, and using the fruits that they pick from the National Assembly to their people as evidence, rather than shortcuts, you know, to particularly violence. This country has had a bit of it, and for the last 40 years under the military regime, we should not be saying that we want to go beyond Museveni with violence.
Council, do you think government uses the judiciary to break the opposition hardliners?
Uses the judiciary or uses the justice, law and order sector? You know, I was very deliberate in explaining what entails an investigation and prosecution. The judiciary does not arraign people before itself. The courts, they listen, they hear and determine cases that have been brought before them. However, there are instances where the judiciary can exercise what they call judicial activism, But that is a gray area, gray zone area. Many persons coached in judicial conduct are reluctant to engage in judicial activism. Judicial activism is, you know, going sometimes beyond the so-called call of duty. And on your own volition, you make a determination of a matter of grave importance, even where the evidence is lacking. But we also have what we call in judicial conduct, judicial practice, what they call exercise of discretionary power. Discretionary authority. Discretionary authority is that you leave it to the person presiding over a matter to determine. It's not really based so much on evidence, but it's based on, it could be based on evidence, but it's based on what they call reason, the reasonableness, and good conscience. In particular, in the Commonwealth, the prevailing jurisprudence that where there is a clash between state interests and individual liberties, fundamental human rights of an individual, you determine a matter that promotes the rights of an individual. That's what they call the horizontal, now the vertical application, state versus individual. State versus individual, that is vertical, rather than individual to what? To individual.
Have there been any ruling in recent times that might...
I know where you want me to go, and that's why I was emphasizing the aspect of judicial activism. And it's like I said, it's a gray zone area. It's a gray zone area.
Do you think that in this particular matter, well, you already said
please. ask me. I'll put it very clearly.
How can the justice system be strengthened to avoid such circumstances?
Like I said, they are robust systems. They are robust systems. The justice, law and order sector has many ambits, I told you. But I forgot to bring out aspects of prisons, local government, gender, but even civil society.
You're being unfair to the judicial process, because where you're going, I think it was much more about the executive reviewing its position when it comes to the three arms.
But how will the executive... How will we check the executive if we don't hold it to account?
Precisely, and that's what I'm trying to say, that actually, if I got you right, you know, you're going back to the nuances suggesting the post-bail application, what actually happened. It is very clear the case that it was a matter for the executive, you know, exercising its authority, which really undermined, in this case, what Edgar managed to successfully defend on behalf of the judiciary, that they did their little bit. You know, so it's much more, really much more the executive rather than...
And not just the executive. After all, Museveni is an elected leader. Although he disputes his re-election. He's an elected leader. Whose responsibility is it to put the elected leaders to task? Whose responsibility is it to hold their leaders to account? Whose is it?
Well...
It's the citizenry.
Yes, it is the citizenry. But I think that...
And if you leave that citizenry in limbo... You know, to the extent that actually, if
I can see where this conversation is.
No, Vivian. For so long as persons in our space, permit boundaries of impunity to be extended, it will come to consume all of us. Whether it is Sewanyanda, what, every one of us, and I dare say, even those who are at the helm of impunity, one day it will take them.
Well, that concludes our show tonight. We have been talking about politics and justice. Unfortunately, I cannot go past this point. Very interesting conversation, gentlemen. Thank you for accepting our invite. I have been with Counsel Edgar Tabaro, a senior advocate at KTA, and policy analyst Mr. Joseph Otieno. Good evening.
Future President of the Republic of Uganda. That's what he calls himself.